Good afternoon. I'll call this meeting to order. This is the meeting of the Health, Environment, and Community Engagement Committee. I'm Chair of the committee, Cam Gordon. And today I'm joined by Councilmembers Glidden, Johnson, and Frye. And we'll probably be joined by Councilmembers Kano and Bender shortly. There's four items on our agenda today. Two of them are consent items, and two are discussion items. I'll read through the consent items, and if any committee member wants to pull something off for discussion or questions, feel free to do so. The first item is a Public Health Advisory Committee appointment, approving the appointment of Dr. Paul Pentel, Ward 7, to the Public Health Advisory Committee for a two-year term beginning January 1, 2017, and ending December 31st, 2018. The second item is accepting a grant from the American Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals to the Minneapolis Animal Care and Control Department for staff training. This is a grant in the amount of $5,000. Questions or comments on those items? Seeing none then, all those in favor, I will move both for approval. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, say no. Those are passed then. Now we move on to our first discussion item. This is receiving the annual report from the Neighborhood and Community Engagement Commission. And Mr. Rubidor is going to introduce it, and then I think we'll hear from commissioners. Welcome.
Chair Gordon and committee members, good afternoon, and thank you for the introduction. Today I'm going to be introducing David Zaffron, who is the chair of the Neighborhood and Community Engagement Commission, who's going to go through the annual report for the committee. He is also joined by several other commissioners that I believe will be adding a few words, but I did want to take a couple of minutes at the very beginning just to kick off the report. The Neighborhood and Community Engagement Commission is a 60-member resident-based advisory commission that supports the City Council and the Neighborhood and Community Relations Department with the city's engagement work. It has eight representatives that are elected by the 70 cities neighborhood organization, five that are appointed by the City Council, two by the mayor, and one by the Park Board. As I mentioned, Commissioner Zaffron will go through the details of the report itself, but I did want to just make a note at the very beginning that this is a very dedicated group of volunteers with our city. The commission has never had a problem reaching quorum. It's been very active, has multiple committees that are up and running that the residents that are on the commission dedicate a great deal of time and effort to this work. And last year alone, over 700 volunteer hours were contributed by the members of this commission. Not only do they focus in on just supporting the city's engagement work, but a large body of their work is focused around equity and inclusion and getting all representatives and all people of the city of Minneapolis engaged in the city's work. So with that, if I may, hand it over to Chair Zaffron to introduce the report.
Thank you. Welcome, Mr. Zaffron.
Thank you, members, for having me here today. And as Director Rubidor mentioned, I'm Dave Zaffron. I'm the current chair of the Neighborhood and Community Engagement Commission. It's my third year serving on the commission, and the first as chair. And I can say from my two-plus years now serving on the NCEC that this is a group of people from year to year that is very dedicated to the work that we have in front of us to improve the city's processes for community engagement, for engagement with neighborhood organizations, and ensuring that all residents in the city are actively engaged both with city enterprise and with city decision making, as well as participating through neighborhood and other organizations to act on neighborhood priorities and put sets of priorities in front of their neighbors and the city that they want to see happen in their communities. So I will walk you through the sections of the report briefly. I'm joined by two other commission members today, Commissioner Jeff Strand and Commissioner Nick Chickowitz, and I'll call them up here for a couple of these sections that they've led work on in the previous year. First off, Commissioner Strand, who's here, as well as former Commissioner Tessa Wiegen, led a strategic planning process that led to the strategic plan that the NCEC adopted last year, and that included clarifying our work plan, clarifying what it is that we want to accomplish as a commission, since there's really a lot that we can look at, and it's been it's a constant iteration with members as the commission evolves what we want to focus in on with our time and energy. Neighborhoods 2020, which was the establishment of a committee to look specifically at the department and the city's practices with neighborhood organizations and looking at how neighborhood organizations should be funded and structured and what their mission ought to be through 2020 and beyond. The Blueprint for Equitable Engagement, which I'll speak to more in a second, and also a process by which the NCEC can adopt policy recommendations to the City Council and to the mayor when appropriate. And so we've come to a conclusion through an ad hoc committee on how we want to do that when it's called for. The Blueprint for Equitable Engagement, as you are probably familiar, is something that the department worked on for a very long time and included several community forums, one of which I attended in my first couple of months on the commission a couple of years ago, to address how the city wants to engage with residents through neighborhood organizations, boards and commissions, and other organizations. And the NCEC had several opportunities to offer our insight and feedback and advice on how to shape that document, and did quite a lot of work with it. And Director Budor could speak in more detail to how the implementation of that blueprint has gone with the NCR department. Last year, we also looked at the guidelines for the community participation program for the next 3-year funding cycle. And so that was a big opportunity to take a look at how the city is prioritizing how we're funding neighborhood organizations and what the city wants to see out of the funds that are going to neighborhood organizations. And there were a number of revisions, both through the department as well as through the NCEC. A couple of the recommendations that came from the NCEC for those guidelines were a longer notice required for neighborhood organization annual meetings so that people have more time to know that those meetings are going to happen and attend, as well as notifications to NCEC members for neighborhood organization applications to CPP and reviews of their CPP plans and funds, just to encourage greater engagement and communication between neighborhood organizations and the NCEC members who represent them on our commission. Community forums have been an ongoing and increasing interest of NCEC members over the last 2 years. We held two in the last year, one last December and another this past June, around specific topics that were of interest to NCEC members as well as community members. And at our last meeting just this fall, we created an ongoing committee of the NCEC to look at putting together a plan for quarterly community forums that would take place in different parts of the city, hopefully in collaboration with neighborhood organizations, again, on specific topics that are of interest to members, community members, and neighborhood organizations in those areas of the city. The One Minneapolis Fund and skipping ahead once to the Community Innovation Fund are the two different grant funds that the NCEC makes recommendations for recipients on to the City Council. You're probably pretty familiar with the One Minneapolis Fund in particular. I feel for my own part that this is, to me, this fund is identified very closely with the NCEC, and it's a big part of our identity as a group and our work. And sort of our priority as a commission in seeing an increase in diversity and inclusion and engagement and participation on behalf of all communities in the city and all people, whether regardless of their level of prior engagement and representation in city government. And I can say that this work has directly led to an increase in the diversity of the participation in city boards and commissions. And so in that sense, it has already had a durable and lasting impact in reaching one of its core goals. And so I think that we should be proud of that work, both as the commission that's made the funding recommendations, as well as this committee and the city council for implementing that plan and that part of our city's racial equity work. The Community Innovation Fund is newer. It's in the second year of its first two-year funding cycle. And this is a fund that was named in the original framework for the future that envisioned the NCEC and the Community Participation Program coming out of the NRP program. And its mission is to seek out locally relevant and innovative solutions to city-identified goals. And in this first funding round, we decided to leave it wide open as far as what those city-identified goals were and let neighborhood organizations tailor their applications to any of the city's identified goals. And I think looking ahead to our next funding round, perhaps we will look at specific city-identified goals that are perhaps seen as more pressing than others. And these are a set of projects that are still in progress, and there will be an initial report on their results from the NCR department soon. I want to step back for a second to the work of the Neighborhood 2020 Committee, which was created last year, again, to take a look at the future of neighborhood organizations in Minneapolis. And they really took on two core pieces of work. One was making recommendations to our full commission on what should happen with the Community Participation Program guidelines. And the other was taking a bit broader of a look at what are ways that the city can better support neighborhood organizations and vice versa, and not just strictly within the bounds of the CPP program. And so to speak more on that, I'll introduce Commissioner Jeff Strand, who has served on that committee in both in a year that he was off of the NCC and then continuing on this year. Thank you.
Welcome, Mr. Strand.
Thank you, Chair Zaffron and Chair Gordon and council members. Jeff Strand, Shingle Creek Neighborhood, Ward 4, council appointee. So the Neighborhoods 2020 Committee intentionally invited non-NCEC members to participate. Excuse me. And so among the recommendations that were developed were that the city require stronger outcomes related to the representative engagement, participation, voting rights, avoidance of exclusion from participation, and better ways to incentivize best practices among neighborhood organizations. The other charge, which the City Council I know is pursuing and has given the staff direction, which the NCR department has engaged with the NCEC, relates to exploring and seeking out future fundings to continue neighborhood programming. Another recommendation was that there be an annual satisfaction survey for both cultural organizations as well as neighborhood organizations on what trainings and resources and support can be provided to those entities by the city in order for those groups and us as resident volunteers to do our work more effectively and better to mutually help reach these city goals and objectives. And in responding to the survey, which really is in keeping with the council adopted IAP2 principles of community engagement, that after such a survey is conducted, the city would evaluate that survey and would respond by increasing the use of those qualified providers that have been identified as most successful by the neighborhood and cultural organizations. So that is fully in keeping with the feedback loop from the IAP2 principles that the council adopted. The committee also asked that the city ensure that neighborhood support staff be fully trained and qualified to fully assist neighborhood organizations in recommending and connecting neighborhoods and cultural organizations with best practices and resources. And I believe the director has taken steps to achieve that recommendation. And I can't cover all of these in the short time today, of course, but I think another important recommendation was that the neighborhood system has to meet the needs of organizations of varying size, capacity, and context. For example, addressing the work of neighborhood and cultural organizations in areas of concentrated poverty or areas of housing decline versus our more affluent neighborhoods in the city. The last point that I'd like to make is, of course, you have the community participation program guidelines. That was a big piece of work product that the committee delivered to the commission, which in turn delivered to the department and the council. The other piece is our neighborhoods 2020 work plan that I know the committee reviewed a couple of weeks ago, and I regret that I was returning from a meeting in Rochester and unable to attend that meeting with Marcus Mills, co-chair of the Neighborhoods 2020 committee. But I will let you know that the committee did approve that draft work plan, and we'll be referring it to the NCEC November meeting in turn to formally review and approve it. So I thank you, council members, for the opportunity to serve again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. The other commissioner I want to introduce to speak to our participation as a commission in the Community Connections Conference is Commissioner Nick Jacobowitz, who took part in the planning committee for that conference this past year.
Okay. Welcome. Good to see you again.
Thank you, Chair Gordon and City Council members. The Community Connections Conference, I should lean back. Community Connections Conference is one of the most important tools that I learned about when I originally started on NCEC. And so I'm an elected commissioner from District 5, and I live in the Bryn Mawr neighborhood in Ward 7. Last year's Community Connection Conference had over 600 attendees from neighborhoods and cultural organizations. One of the things that I learned early on is that NCR as a department really wanted more participation from NCEC at this event and NCEC commissioners. And so we had over 12 commissioners who were involved in the actual conference. We did a learning lab where individuals could come in and learn about the NCEC, they could learn about NCR. And so overall, we felt like the participation really increased. This year, we're looking for even more participation. We'd like to have all 16 commissioners there, really spreading the word about NCEC, because we want more people to get involved with NCEC as well. And so NCEC, kind of from a selfish perspective, wants individuals to know about us, because if people know about what NCEC is doing, we can really be a better voice for the community. So last year was seen as a very big success for NCR and NCEC. As we move forward, we're starting the planning process and really reaching out to neighborhoods, reaching out to other cultural communities. We'd love to have another 100 or so people at this year's event, but last year we felt as though we really got the word out, and we're hoping to really revamp and work with NCR and Director Rubidor to find different ways this year to reach out to the community so that there's more participation. And so overall, last year was a success, but we hope this year is an even bigger success. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think we might have a question on the Community Connections Conference. I'm not sure, Councilmember Bender.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I did have a question about the conference, and also just maybe how it fits in more broadly with NCEC's work around kind of engaging with folks who may not know about NCEC, or particularly who may not be involved in their neighborhood board. And I wondered, there's a pretty big time commitment, and I know people can come and go. So I think it's super valuable for those who have the time to really drill in. But I wondered if you've discussed ways that you could use that kind of model, but do smaller things that might be at different times or shorter that would kind of build on that. Anyway, it just occurred to me, so I wanted to ask.
No, definitely. Back to a little bit of what Chair Zaffron talked about. That's what some of the kind of community forums that we're hoping can kind of become, where they're not only about a specific topic, but they're also about learning about the NCEC. In our community forum in December, there were a lot of people. I think we had 40 to 50 individuals who attended that, and a consistent question was, who are you? We don't know who you are, because some of our members are really involved in their local community, and some of them are involved more enterprise-wise with the city. And so what we're talking about with community connections is how can, if we have 100% participation, how can that lead to more people understanding that there are other opportunities within CEC? So there's different task force, there's other committees, and there's opportunities for individuals to really get involved on that, you know, maybe 4-month process, so they don't have to be on the commission to actually play a role. One of the other things that we're really stressing this year is finding a way to kind of redefine what does it mean to be a commissioner. So how are you getting out into the community as an NCEC commissioner, whether you're elected or appointed, to really spread the word and get more people involved and really learn what their perspective is?
Thank you. And with that, I would submit the report for your consideration. And are there any other questions from the committee?
I have a couple questions, and maybe we'll have a few more. I was curious about the December forum that was held. Was there any follow-up about that? Was some of the information that you gathered? I attended that forum. That was at a very, I think it was a useful forum. That was a very challenging time in the city. People might remember back to last December. And there was a lot of discussion about relationship between city government generally, but also the police and the community. And I may have missed any follow-up, or maybe you can just tell us, what did you do with the information that you gathered there?
Sure. There was a lot. So all of the comments from that evening were recorded, and we revisited those at a committee of the meeting afterwards in order to really process all of that input and information that came through at that forum and see how we can, like, where it fits into our work, frankly. And I think a lot of it fits into the work that we do in making recommendations on how city departments engage with residents around the city. And so that's where that's the committee to which a lot of that work was assigned, and how we've chosen to look at what our recommendations would be coming out of that. I also know that the department, for having been there to take part and facilitate the forum and record all the information, has continued to work, you know, across the city, in both geographically, but then also in various cultural communities and different specific communities of interest, to increase engagement and facilitate engagement with city enterprise, different city departments, and I believe Director Reuter has a little bit further comment on that.
Okay.
Thank you. Chair Gordon and committee members, I would also say that that forum also helped inform the body camera engagement process that we laid out for with the police department and moving forward with the development of that policy.
Well, I just will note that there's a lot of work that got done in the past year. I know that the Blueprint for Equity and the whole community participation program review and rewrite, that was very significant. I know there was also an evaluation that happened, and I think the commissioners participated in that evaluation. I'm a little bit curious about a couple things, and maybe this is more looking to the future, but the commission is divided into appointees and people who are elected by neighborhood organizations. Does that seem to be working well? I know with the first couple of years, it seemed like there was a clear divide in the commission, and maybe it wasn't as functional as it is today. I'm just curious if you ever talk about that as commissioners, and if you have any thoughts on that.
I'll say as far as what's coming up, as well as for my own part, our next committee, the whole meeting next week, is going to be looking at one of the recommendations that came out of the neighborhood audit report from this last year, which is about the whether or not the NCC and the NRP policy board ought to be one body instead of two. And so I think that that's going to be a big opportunity to discuss that very question as far as representation and from where and from whom, between appointees and representatives from neighborhoods, since that's a big factor in that question. And so I don't, in my experience, that's not something that's explicitly named, and I don't see a big difference in how different commissioners engage with the commission or participate in the commission or participate in their neighborhoods, for that matter. But I can't speak to the commission as a whole. I think that there's a high level of attendance and participation and engagement on behalf of everybody, both appointees and elected. And it's something that we'll be discussing more soon.
Do you think the neighborhood representatives go back to their neighborhood organizations? And is there a way for them to communicate and get input? And I know it's just their representatives from those districts, and I'm curious about how well that's working.
I think that's something that Commissioner Chickwich just spoke to a little bit, as far as, you know, what is the level of expectation for individual commissioners, whether they are appointed or elected? And for the elected representatives, what is the expectation as far as two-way communication with neighborhood organizations? Without putting words in Commissioner Strand's mouth, I know I've heard him say previously that as a commissioner who has represented an elected district of neighborhoods, that it is a challenge to communicate regularly with every single neighborhood organization in one of the districts on a regular basis, just given the number of neighborhood organizations that there are. And I think that it is probably fairly varied across different districts around the city. And I'll just say again, for my own part, having witnessed the elections this year for the elected commissioners, there was a very high level of engagement in most of those elections, both from electors from neighborhood organizations as well as from multiple candidates for a number of those seats. And to me, that's a sign that there is a high level of engagement on the part of neighborhood organizations with the work of the NCC and an awareness, as well as an interest on the part of people who applied for the commission from those districts to have a relationship with their neighborhood organizations.
Excellent. I did have a thought once that maybe we should have those elections at the Community Connections Conference, or see how we can maybe create some more synergy there. So that's more things to discuss, and I know there's lots of work we have ahead of us. I don't have any other questions. I don't see any other questions or comments here, but thank you so much for the hard work that you do, and it's all voluntary, and we really appreciate it and appreciate this outstanding report.
Thank you, Chair Gordon.
With that, I'll move to receive and file the commission annual report. Any discussion on that? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed say no. And then we'll move on to our last item, which is a report on the One Minneapolis Annual Outcomes Report. Mr. Rubidor.
Chair Gordon and committee members, again, David Rubidor, Director of the Neighborhood and Community Relations Department. Again, on this report, I'm going to just cue this up at the beginning and then introduce Justin Gorder, who is an intern at the NCR department. Justin is the one who put together the report. I thought it was an excellent report, and I asked him if he'd like the opportunity to present and discuss this with the council, and he said yes. So he will be up here in a minute. But first, to cue this up a little bit, the One Minneapolis report before you is for the 2014 funding cycle. I just want to make a note at the beginning, this funding cycle is basically for One Minneapolis start about 6 months after the approval of the budget, because it's needs to be approved by the council on an annual basis. And so by the time we get through the RFP process and the selection process, most of the organizations get their work underway around June or July of the grant year. And then we give them 18 months to complete the project. So in this particular cycle, the organizations were completing their work at the end of December of 2015. And thus, why you have the report before you today. The program itself is to provide community-based nonprofit organizations with the ability to support diverse leadership and community engagement in the city of Minneapolis. And really, the intent behind this fund is really to be able to partner with community-based organizations that are already doing engagement and leadership development in the community, and really develop a strong partnership between the city and the community. So in essence, really finding where those points of accent are, or those points within the community where good work is already being done, and then developing a partnership with those organizations to continue to do that. We're really looking to try to increase the number of underrepresented communities on Minneapolis boards and commissions through this work, increase the involvement of residents in under-engaged communities in policy decisions. Should probably jump to the next page there. And increase the involvement of residents of underrepresented communities and neighborhood and community organizations. In 2014, the One Minneapolis Fund was at $80,000. It has since grown to $182,000 in the following years. But in 2014, we were able to contract with seven different organizations. I think we ended up with some really good results for the year. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Justin Gorder for the continuation of the report.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Director Rubidor.
Good afternoon. I have a quick question for Mr. Rubidor from Councilmember Fry.
Sorry, before we kick it off here. So, Mr. Rubidor, this is just for the year of 2014 when the funds were actually used. So anything in 2015 hasn't been registered yet. Is that right? Or we haven't gotten the reports back?
Chair Gordon and Councilmember Fry, yes, the 2015 cycle would have started in July of 2015, and it actually goes to the end of this year.
Right.
And then there's a 2016 cycle that just started. Okay. So there's two cycles right now that grantees are continuing to do the work. So at the end of next month, the 2015 cycle will end, and a report will be coming out after that for the 2015 cycle.
Okay, so this is just from the cycle starting in July of 2014, ending in July of 2015.
That is, Chair Gordon and Council Member, that is correct.
Okay.
Yes, Council Member Glidden.
So, thank you. I just wanted to know, so you talked about one of the goals being to assist in helping bring new applicants to the city's many boards and commissions. Is that something that was articulated as a goal in the RFP in general? Because as I'm looking through the summaries, I think I only see one of the projects that collected data, or at least collected data in a way that was shared in this report, on that question.
Chair Gordon and Council Vice President Glidden, the actual in the RFP process is around building leadership and engagement within cultural communities, and that's the defined goal. The internal goals that we do within the department is to make sure that when people are being engaged and they're actually developing leadership, is that we're being intentional about supporting those connections. In this particular cycle, Lake Street Council actually had a very specific program about training people to be on boards and commissions, and so their outcomes were directly related to that. Generally, as we're selecting applicants, or grantees for this program, we're looking for those direct connections with supporting other work in the city. But in the RFP, it's more general about leadership development and engagement and leaving it up to organizations to submit ideas around how to do that.
Councilman Member Fry also has another question.
I guess this is part of my concern, is that clearly, Lake Street Council did a good job. It says they recruited and prepared 14 individuals who submitted 13 applications, ultimately resulting in 7 applicants. That's like an objective, positive result. You know, and as I'm looking through the booklet, the vast majority of the rest of the results are not really measurable at all. It's holding a meeting or a forum or a series of meetings, and they're not necessarily tied to the goals, one, but two, they don't necessarily deliver on the promises that were made through the RFP. Or three, they're really good outcomes, but they're something that the organization was already doing before, regardless of the money that was allocated.
Chair Gordon and Councilmember Fry, one of the things I would say that with the 2014 report, the program has since evolved in 2015 and 16, is we've been more specific within specific areas. So part of this is a reflection of the program at the time period that it came out. So I know in the preceding years, we were much more specific about which groups we were trying to target and in order to engage. So the results that you're seeing really is from, in essence, the second year of the program. So again, we've highlighted and enhanced that particular piece. But ultimately, what the RFP was requesting was for organizations to develop and support leadership development within underengaged communities, which arguably, in many of these situations, they were doing that. Our goal is to making sure that we're connecting that with city work.
Okay, I think I would like to further ask questions, but I think it'll be more on the specifics, so I'll kind of let the presentation continue.
Good afternoon, Chair Gordon, Council Members. My name is Justin Gorder. I'm an intern with the Neighborhood and Community Relations Department. I will just be kind of going over a brief overview of key outcomes from the One Minneapolis Fund. As Director Rubidor said, the program was expanded from $65,000 to $80,000 in the 2014 cycle, which allowed us to fund seven organizations. The first year we funded three. Through the support of the One Minneapolis Fund, these projects were able to engage 318 diverse residents. They also conducted resident surveys on 5,000 residents. More than 15 trainings and workshops were held around developing leadership skills and knowledge of the civic process to enable underrepresented communities to be able to more fully participate in their communities and in local government. More than 20 meetings were held to inform residents on issues going on in the city and decisions being made that directly affect them. And also give them a platform to be able to have their voices heard. Recruitment and training led to 13 people of color applying to boards and commissions, seven of which were appointed. Project efforts contributed to policy change by assisting in the passing of two new city ordinances related to food equity in the city. Many of the projects engaged youth in some capacity. 62 youth participated in overall. 105 activities were offered. The activities revolved around youth leadership and civic engagement and health activities. And 27 youth were employed. A highlight of the youth activities was a partnership made with the University of Minnesota Extension Cooking Matters, where they set up a weekly cooking class for the youth to be able to learn how to cook a healthy meal. And afterwards, they were given the groceries to bring home and cook them for their families. I will go over some of the project highlights. Appetite for Change trained seven North Minneapolis community members to better understand the complex food system issues in the city of Minneapolis so that they would be able to become food ambassadors for their communities and engage in organizing and advocacy around food equity. They were also one of 10 organizations that were selected to be a part of a national cohort around food equity. They were invited by the Union of Concerned Scientists. Asian Media Access invited 100 underrepresented community members to submit business plans along with initial startup funding costs, which were included in market cluster research that they did.
There might be a question on this specific one. Is that right, Council Member Fry?
Yeah, I've probably got questions on each of them.
Yeah.
Do you want to wait till the end, or?
Whichever is easier.
Why don't you hit them as we go, I guess? So.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. I'm sorry, I forgot your last name, Mr.
Gorder.
Mr. Gorder.
Yeah.
Thank you for the work you're doing and the presentation. And, you know, I know a lot of this comes from a direction by the city council for you guys to move forward with this. I have a bunch of questions that I have.
Okay.
So first, regarding the appetite for change, it says provided employment opportunities for 21 youth. What exactly does that mean? I mean, we only gave $15,000 in total. How are 21 youth employed?
They didn't go into very specific detail about the employment opportunities. They did discuss the fact that they were surprised and impressed by how involved the youth did get in a lot of their policy and advocacy work. I know that some of them went with when they went to this meeting of the national cohort.
Yep.
But in their report they submitted, they did not discuss in detail what the employment opportunities were.
So I think this is something that we definitely need to follow up on. I mean, if we're doling out money and they're saying 21 youth have been given employment opportunities, which sounds like a great result, but if you look at the actual statistics, that doesn't make any sense to me whatsoever. So, I mean, maybe there's something that I'm not seeing. Maybe they connected them with other employers, but we need to look into see what they actually did rather than just putting the numbers down. So, and the second thing is, you know, it says, It says engage 31 youth through trainings and community organization. That's great, but this doesn't appear to be one of the promises made. This appears to be something that they were already doing, is engaging youth generally, regardless of the allocation of $15,000. Good thing, but they were already doing it, regardless of the money that we were getting. And then, okay, fair point about the ordinance. They did do some work on that, and I remember it. And then the second thing with the Asian media access.
Mm-hmm.
The fourth piece, which is worked with UROC and Cura to update UROC's Northside asset mapping website, like that's a thing. That's an objective, clear thing that they accomplished. At least the first two on there that I'm seeing, they invited 100 people to submit business ideas. Again, it's more difficult to decipher a result there.
Yeah, in the report, a lot of the things from those discussions they were incorporating in things that they referred to as related to their future visioning plan that they were going to be starting after this grant cycle. So a lot of it was research around the things that they wanted to discuss while making this economic development vision plan.
Okay. Okay, you can keep going. I probably have more questions, and I'll just kind of ask him, Mr. Chair, if that's all right, as we go.
Yep.
Yeah,
that's excellent.
So, like you mentioned, they worked with UROC and Kira to update that Northside asset mapping site. They added health information, urban gardens, physical exercise opportunities, and they also made the map interactive, so community members would be able to add activities to the map. The Council on American Islamic Relations hosted a voter registration booth at Twin Cities Day of Dignity. They were able to register 50 residents to vote. They also traveled to Washington, D.C. To join 280 delegates from over 20 states at the first ever National Muslim Day. They met with elected officials and Congress staffers. And they were also split into groups to meet with representatives from Minnesota. And they were able to meet with all 10 of Minnesota's federal legislators.
So on this one, I've got a couple questions too. So the registered 50 people to vote during the vote registration drive, again, that's a result. That's a clear objective that was met. The participated in the first ever Muslim National Muslim Advocacy Day. So was this made possible by the One Minneapolis grant, or is this just something that the organization did?
They specified it as one of the things that they did.
So that's what we need to be really tracking here. I mean, we're giving money out, and we need to say, are these results, these victories that they're claiming, and yes, I would agree, 50 people being registered to vote, that's a clear, tangible victory. But I mean, with this second piece, also, you know, potentially a very good thing, but are we paying for their flight? Are we paying for their hotel? What exactly is our money going to? That's what I would like to know, I think, going into the future.
Okay.
Sorry, keep going.
Yeah. So the Lake Street Council held two trainings in two different languages, focused on applying for boards and commissions. 48 people attended those trainings. And as mentioned before, that resulted in 13 people applying and 7 being appointed. They also expanded their own leadership by appointing 2 entrepreneurs of color to their board.
So on this one, if you want to go back, I think the recruitment of the 14 individuals and ultimately having 7 appointed, I mean, that's one of the core goals of One Minneapolis. It is to diversify our boards and commissions here at the city. And I applaud Lake Street Council for finding a way to get 7 new people on there. That's great. That's a real result. A lot of these other things, though, it's not at all related to the One Minneapolis grant. You know, the 60 entrepreneurs of color voiced their opinion about equity issues to elected officials. Also, it's a good thing, but it has no relation, as far as I can tell, to the money that we gave them. And if it does, I would certainly welcome that information. The hosted 16 meetings. Again, I'm trying to figure out what the relationship is.
I think a big part of it is getting involved more in just local government and the civic process in general, especially the trainings. But I think that that is how they're trying to connect it to the goals.
I don't dispute that all of these are good things. The question is whether these are objectives that are part of their organization's mission, their general mission, or this is the result of the money we gave them.
Right.
Hi, Chair Gordon, if I may step in for a minute. Just again, Justin, being relatively new to this, if I may address Councilmember Fry's concerns there. You are exactly right. The One Minneapolis grant program is a small grant program, and I don't think any of these initiatives would be supported by this program in its entirety. That they are actually using the funds to supplement and support other activities that they have going on. The first couple of years when the program went out, we were a little bit more general in the grant guidelines that were issued in order really just being able to support leadership development and getting more civic engagement and more engagement by communities of color and people of color within the city. We've become much more intentional about making sure that those connections in the later grant cycles are directly related back to city work. So I brought up in 2015, I brought up the guidelines, which have been enhanced and actually approved by the City Council, both in 2015 and the 2016 grant cycles, is that the community and cultural organizations should submit proposals for projects that develop leadership, engage communities, and result in increased involvement in city leadership structures by diverse people. For the purposes of the RFP, the city leadership structures refers to City of Minneapolis boards, commissions, neighborhood organizations, and other similar advisory or civic engagement groups. In 2014, that language was not included in there, but as the program has evolved, we've become more specific, I think, to a number of the points that you are raising, making sure that the work is not supplementing things that were already going to be happening, but is much more intentional about providing pathways for community leadership into the city structure. So in this current cycle, it was more general. In latter cycles, that has since been corrected.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mr. Yeah. Bruno.
So it might
go ahead.
Just given this discussion, it might have been helpful if we had, I guess, the original RFP available. I was trying to access it online as Councilmember Fry's been asking questions about it. I did find 2013s and 2015s, and clearly the expectations did change, and it's been growing through there. I haven't found 2014s yet, but that's all right. But I think that it probably was more general funding to support things like building capacity, reaching out to diverse communities, and engaging them. But
Chair Gordon, I also looked online while the discussion was going on, and the previous cycle RFPs are not on there, but 15 and 16 are. 2015.
Well, maybe you can, if we find those, maybe you can help get them to us so that at least committee members can check them out if they want to.
But just, if Chair Gordon, if I would just reemphasize the point, I think Councilmember Fry's point is very valid, and that actually led to the evolution of the program guidelines as it was rolling out, making sure we were driving to results that were measurable within the city structure.
Absolutely. Did you have more questions, Councilmember Fry?
I do, but on the next, there's still more to come.
Yeah, okay.
And Justin, you're doing a great job.
Thank you. Okay, so Twin Cities Media Alliance, they hosted media literacy workshops that focused on photography, news reporting, blogging, video production, and social media to provide participants with the skills needed to shift how North Minneapolis is portrayed in the media, and also to help them become leaders in the community. They partnered with community groups to find locations and to recruit participants in these programs, and they recruited 5 media professionals to teach the workshops. 10 workshops were held in total, and they were attended by 16 community members.
Right, so on this one, it's more of this, kind of the same concern. It's the result are the holding of 10 workshops. And 16 people in total from the $10,000 allocation.
So I think we need to be, and I'm sure we're, you know, hopefully we're doing this in 2016 and moving forward 2015. But we need to be really specific, I think, going forward. So yeah, keep going.
And Councilmember Frey, they did get, a result of the program. They had a number of articles published in the Daily Planet. So that is kind of a solid outcome.
What were those articles?
I don't have the specifics on exactly what they were. They encouraged people to just kind of write articles about issues that were going on to kind of engage their community, basically.
Yeah, I would like to know. I'd be really interested to see which articles those were. So this is in the year of 2014?
Yep.
I guess 2015, okay.
And youth care provided leadership opportunities by assisting youth in planning and leading a 125 participant lock-in at the North Community YWCA. They also developed presentations for the youth care board of directors meeting. They also conducted focus area sessions that helped participants develop skills in health and wellness, teen tech, and in arts and culture. And Voices for Racial Justice did not submit a final report due to staffing changes in the organization.
So the organization still exists, right?
Yes, I believe so.
Have we reached out to them again to ask for a report?
Not recently, no.
They did submit a letter that's attached to the
there is
to the staff report.
Mid-report.
Chair Gordon, Councilmember Frey, we've made a number of requests for Voices for Racial Justice to submit the final report that never came in. We did get a midterm report on it.
Okay. So going back to the youth care, because I don't have any information to really ask about the Voices for Racial Justice, but on the youth care, so the first one, it says worked with youth to plan and lead a lock-in for over 125 teens at the North Community YMCA. I mean, this is an annual event that they have, regardless of the funding that we gave them. So this event would have taken place anyway, regardless of our allocation. And then the second one is, supported youth in developing a presentation for the youth care board of directors. This was also, it's not clear that this was made possible by the One Minneapolis Fund. I guess this is the same questions that I've had in some of the others, which is, it's just not clear. I mean, it sounds like their mission statement and the activities that they're already involved in.
Chair Gordon, if I may just respond to that a little bit. Chair Gordon and Councilmember Frey, I think you're correct in that pretty much a number of these projects would exist outside of the One Minneapolis Fund. The idea here is that many of these organizations really have a difficult time continuing to do this work. As a result, these grants were given out as a way to continue to support, in essence, good work that was out there, also as ways to build a relationship with the city and continuing to be providing pathways for underengaged communities to really connect with the city and using these grants as a way to develop that. As this as this program has evolved, we've changed that and the guidelines have been changed in order to be more specific in that particular area. I think it's safe to say in the first two cycles, the first cycle, I forgot the grant amount, I think it was $50,000 or $60,000 total, $65,000 total. It was really these were the first two initial years. It has honed in much more specific in that particular area, because we were finding that the general results were we were supporting work that was going out there. We needed to be more intentional about not only to develop a relationship, but then also to providing those pathways into the city. Into civic engagement. So I think your points that you're making are very valid and very accurate. In a couple of situations, they were very specific outcomes that came in that were directly related to what the overall goals are. the program has changed since that time. The report is a bit dated simply because of the lag in the funding cycle.
Councilmember Bender also had a question, and then Councilmember Kano.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Now, I just wanted to note that, I mean, I think these are all good questions, and it's important to have sort of transparency in our documentation, but, you know, these are very small grants that we're giving, and so then there's probably a policy question to ask, which is, you know, do we want to give grants of $5,000, that small amount, and then what could we expect for that? And I also just wanted to note, I think that the degree to which, you know, the specificity and the overall report from each organization probably also represents that organization's overall capacity as much as it does the particular grant we gave. And I don't know all of these organizations super well, but the ones I do, I can kind of think to my head how many staff they have and how many programs they have and how that may have influenced how they were able to report on this. So I think this presentation was really helpful. I think it probably raises some policy questions about, with a very small amount of overall funding allocated to this program, is it better to keep spreading it out to try to get to a number of different cultural communities and a number of different types of outreach and engagement? And if so, then I think, you know, these amounts of funding are just very small. And so anyway, that's just a comment.
Councilmember Kano.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So as I'm listening to the questions from council members, I just wanted to offer maybe one way that we could look at this moving forward. And I'm sharing this as a person who worked in the nonprofit world for a long time in a very grassroots organization where we didn't have retirement funds, we didn't have benefits, we didn't have a lot of the things that obviously we have now as council members. But one of the things that I'm noticing is that obviously every dollar counts, every dollar matters for these small organizations that are doing this work. And I know that a lot of times when we used to put grant applications together, there would be multiple sources of money that would fund one project. Mm-hmm. And so when you report back on that project, all of those sources of funding get credit for making that work happen. And we wouldn't sit there and churn out, was it half a person that was served by the $10,000 or was it three people that were served by the $5,000? That kind of metrics is actually counterproductive to the overall work of the organizations, just because there's just not enough capacity to illustrate the work in such a granular manner where the fine details of these fibers of work actually take up more time in reporting than in doing the actual impact and work in the community. So I think in the future, the one change that I would suggest or addition is, you know, if these folks are reporting back to us, just to let us know, you know, if this is part of a larger pool of dollars that helped to make this work come together, then just acknowledging that, you know, the project to register 50 people probably cost, you know, $55,000 to $70,000. And so the $10,000 is just a part of that work. And so just being able to identify how our dollars are being leveraged with other resources in the community so that we can better reflect the amount of partnerships and work that it takes to do the work that these organizations are churning out.
Thank you, Councilmember Frye.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So yeah, I think that's exactly right. So the big question here, I think, is first of all, we have to acknowledge that yes, our $10,000 or $15,000 is part of a much greater overall funding project that these organizations are going through. When we give $10,000 or $15,000 out, I don't think it's fair for us to claim credit for a lot of the work when certainly there are probably other jurisdictions, other grant associations that are probably further facilitating this work than we are. But I think the big policy question is are we giving this money for specific projects, or are we, the city, a grant organization that's helping to further the overall objective and vision of these nonprofits? And it's a fair policy question, but it's one that we should probably be very honest about with ourselves and what we're doing and what we're not doing.
So I did go back and I looked at the RFP for 2012 and 2013, and it was clear then we were reaching out to try to support groups that were trying to build a more inclusive city. That was called the, I think we had a city goal back then that was many people, one Minneapolis. And the organizations they were looking for were grounded in cultural and our community organizations and actively working towards building an inclusive Minneapolis. The five broad things they were looking at is engagement strategies that can build social capital, promote socioeconomic equity, foster partnerships, strengthen leadership, and increase inclusion. So I think based on that, and I'm not sure what the how much that followed over to the next year in those applications, but I think that was part of it. We were trying to help build a little capacity to help make it a more inclusive city. So that's probably why there was some of these projects are all over the board and they're very different from one another, but they're trying to do outreach and engagement and get people more involved in what's going on. So I guess I'd encourage us to check out what the request for proposal looks like for this year. We'll expect to get the 2015 report sometime early next year. And so look at that. And the 2016, I think each request for proposal has gotten more formal and more clarity was added to it as we went along. I do know that I think there was significantly more added to the budget in 2015. It was almost doubled, as I recall. So we'll see. And I'm sure we know who's got the funding already and who applied for that, so we could check on that too. That seems to have encouraged some more comments here. Councilmember Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I just wanted to say that I understand the evolution of this with the RFP, and I think that that's helpful with this. And I think from the questions, it's some good feedback for, as you look at 2015 results, less ambiguity in those reports and just more specific details around how many people served and what specifically happened. I know sometimes, especially coming from working with a lot of nonprofits and being on the board of nonprofits previously, you know, it's easy sometimes to get really used to your mission statements and to talking in certain terms. And I think that in this particular case, there's an opportunity for us to encourage getting away from that a bit and really getting into what are the specifics that are happening out in the community, how many people are being served. Because I know there's a lot of great work that goes on through these organizations, and I think that it's really an opportunity to highlight that and any assistance we can provide in helping them kind of cut through, I guess, some of the nonprofit speak or some of the kind of organizational speak that occurs with this is helpful. So that's just feedback, no need for response, but I appreciate all of the questions and answers and all the work overall that we're doing. Thanks.
Councilmember Bender.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Could you tell us how the RFP is structured and if there's a range of request, like the budget amount request for each individual application? Or perhaps you could just send it to us for follow-up.
Chair Gordon and Councilmember Bender, I'd be happy to send you the actual RFP that was for the current cycle. Typically, there's a limit on how much they can get. I will say, to your point earlier, is that in these initial years, the grants were really small. As the program has gotten, as the fund for the entire balance of the program has increased, the grant amount goes up, as it now goes up to $25,000. And with that comes higher expectations around the reporting and also just the general evolution about the reporting around specific outcomes. So I think all the comments today have been very helpful in as we do our next round of collecting the reports, including how these grants are and these contracts are actually partnered with other funding sources and making sure we understand the full complexity or the size of the programs that we're actually supporting in the reporting part itself, but I can send you the RFPs. So
thank you. That's helpful. And then I just had another question along with that, which was the level of specificity in what we're how we're opening up the application. So if there's some questions about the different kinds of work that's happening, anyway, seems like another balance of being very open-ended and letting organizations self-define what kinds of things they want to bring forward versus us being more directive in the kind of work that we hope we can fund through this grant program. So you could respond to that, or could just leave it as a comment to follow up after I remind myself the details that are in the RFP. I know we've seen it before, I just don't remember.
Chair Gordon, Councilmember Bender, if I understood your question correctly, it's much more specific and much more directed at this point. There's two different types of groups of funding for two different types of outcomes that we're looking for from the organizations. And again, as this has evolved, it's become much more specific. So
I guess I'll just note, I mean, I really appreciate this presentation. We created this fund, the city, I think in order to supplement the work that our staff is doing, the work that our neighborhood organizations are doing, in order to fill some of those gaps that we know we're not hitting. We're trying to do better. We're trying to be more inclusive in our city-directed outreach. We're trying to help and support and encourage our neighborhood organizations to be more inclusive, but we know we're still missing cultural communities and folks who aren't represented through those methods of engagement. So I think this is really important work. And so there's certainly, I think, always ways to refine that kind of work and decisions to make about how many organizations to support versus maybe supporting a few in a more meaningful way. But I just want to say overall, I really appreciate where this is trying to go, and thanks for the report.
I was just trying to think back to the previous reports we had about this, and I think that after the first year, we may have had some of the grantees come in and talk about what they did. And I was struck by how the committee at that time was incredibly excited about it and thought One Minneapolis was just absolutely fantastic. It was just a little different this year. And I'm not quite sure why, but yeah, it was. So we might want to think about something like that next time. Councilmember Fry.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to reiterate a point. Every one of these organizations is doing extraordinary work. There's no question about that. The question is, how are we allocating funds? At what dollar amount are we allocating funds? And then what are the end results that we're specifically looking for? And you know, I'm glad that we're being more specific about that for 15 and 16. And you know, as Councilmember Bender mentioned, that you know, we are trying to broaden the diversity of a lot of our, for instance, neighborhood associations, a lot of our boards and commissions. I think that is a critical result that we need to be looking at. And if that is in fact a critical result that we specifically value, that should be the goal. If it's not, if it's something else, then we can certainly go that direction as well, and that's a policy consideration to be made.
Yeah, and I think that we did clarify that goal, including involvement in neighborhood organizations, although I still think the last RFP was, it sort of listed examples of expectations, and then there was a general phrase maybe, or other leadership opportunities in the city. And I also think it's very important that we take it very seriously where we're spending the public's money and these grant dollars, what it's going to support, what it isn't. I don't want to act like I don't, and the more we can clearly tie it to identifiable goals, the better as far as I'm concerned. I think we sometimes as a city do maybe too much of these small granting out in these little contracts, thinking we're making a bigger difference than we are, just because we think, oh, we've invested it in something good. So I appreciate people taking a look at it, asking questions, and being attentive. So thank you very much, Councilmember Fry, and everybody else. Councilmember Cano, did you have any more comments?
No, sir.
All right, then I think we're prepared to vote to receive and file. Thank you very much for the presentation.
Thank you.
I will move to receive and file. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. That motion carries. And then seeing no further business before us, this meeting is adjourned. Thank you, everybody.